Andrew, we're back on. How was that? Reb Fountain.
It's great.
From Auckland.
Great. And you've shared that with me now, so I know where to go and look for it.
Yeah. She was going to come and do a house concert at Simon and Pip Burt's in early November, but for some reason it was called off. We were all looking forward to having her back. She's been here two or three times and performed there. And I heard her at WOMAD just before lockdown, the first one. With her band, and she's got a lovely voice, and all those songs she writes herself.
She would be good in the Wellesley wing then.
She would, yeah, yeah. We could set up a special Reb Fountain show when we get the new baffling in.
I think that might be an application, Rob.
Yeah, an application, yeah. Let me just click back to the laptop, and we'll get our apprenticeship story going again. Now, you've got some other photos. I don't know where these came from.
Oh, now there's a good one. That's Wairarapa College.
Yeah.
And so the, and again, I'm guessing your listeners will all know about the Wairarapa College farm, but the trust owns that.
Yeah.
It's 13 hectares, or about 32 acres if you're my age or older.
Yeah.
But it runs from Pownall Street back to the railway lines.
It's nearly in town.
Yeah, it's in town. It's just, you know, it's a couple hundred metres down from the school.
Yeah.
And The trust is, that was one of the original land holdings of the trust, and it's had various uses over the years. But Wairarapa College commenced leasing it off the trust in 1955.
Mm.
So they've been there 65 years.
Mm.
I did agriculture there a few years ago now.
What did agriculture mean in those days? Learning to shear a sheep? Dag a sheep?
I could dag a sheep, roughly, and I could pluck a dead one.
Yeah.
Back when plucking wool was what.
And you could pick up a hay bale?
Yeah, pick up a hay bale.
Did you drive the hay baler?
I drove a few trucks in my day.
Yeah.
But
did you grow some crops there as well as have livestock?
No, it was just livestock back then, Rob. Nowadays they're broadening a bit. They put in about 160 olive trees 2 years ago.
Yeah.
I think they may have some beehives there now. They've got sheep and got a few calves this year.
So how does it work in the classroom situation? Do the kids have a class on the farm, or do they have a day on the farm?
I think the classes, I think, get out on the farm as they need, so they're out regularly.
Yeah.
They also have a trades academy. So I think this year, they had 340 students at the school doing agriculture.
Mm-hmm.
Within that group, so that's sort of what I call third form to seventh form, I think they call now years 9 to 13.
Mm.
They have this rural trades academy, and I'm not quite sure how that works with the Ministry of Education, but that's students that are doing, I think, a bit more practical, and so it's a two-year program.
Mm-hmm.
And the second year, so the two-year program, they're learning practical skills, farming skills.
Mm-hmm.
And the second year of that, they do one day a week out in industry. So they're on sheep farms, beef farms, dairy farms, working with farmers and sort of developing practical skills.
It must take a lot of organising.
I think, luckily we're not involved with that.
And a fair few safety issues, I'd imagine, they'd have to keep an eye on, wouldn't they?
Yep, and I think a bit like maybe a tractor and a bulldozer in the local park, you know, your health and safety can go a bit far.
Yeah,
It has, you know, the reality is people are going to work on farms, and so they need to learn to ride motorbikes and use chainsaws, I guess.
Yeah, and learn to use them safely and confidently.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. So there must have been a fair bit of pressure to sell that land at some point.
There has been over the years. In fact, there was a scheme done in the 1970s, I think the late 70s, to turn that into high-value residential, a subdivision. And, you know, luckily for Marston, it didn't happen, I guess.
Yeah.
You know, there's not too many schools in a town the size of Marston with 32 acres next door. In fact, the school has a bit of land themselves.
Yes.
On the campus, which I think is maybe 5 or 6 acres, so they've got close to 40 acres, which is significant.
Sure.
And in 2019, I think, at least a year ago, almost 2 years ago, we worked with the school and set up an MOU, a memorandum of understanding, to try and better align our interests. I say ours, the trusts, I guess I mean the people of Masterton, really. And what we were hearing from industry was just a bit of a disconnect between industry needs and what the Ministry of Education requires in terms of, of teaching. And so with the school, we put together an advisory panel that's a team of about six industry experts to provide a bit of guidance and context for the school. So those industry experts have got farming backgrounds, fertilizer. So a person with grows olives, has an olive orchard, a beekeeper, I think, those types of skills. And so they're providing, you know, direct industry feedback into the school to try and get that.
Because the return on that land would be peanuts compared to what you could get if you were commercially leasing the land.
So with the concession, we with our rental concessions, and in fact the radio station here is on a rental concession.
Yes, Michael mentioned that to me and said I should thank you very much on behalf of all of us.
it's a pleasure. And Wairarapa College likewise, the rent concession there is about $123,000 a year, so that's I guess that's sort of, in a sense, that's the cost to the community of providing that farm. And so we'd need to make sure that they're doing as much with it as they can.
Yes.
And so this advisory group and this memorandum of understanding has gone a long way towards achieving that. And there's there's now, you know, as I said, 340 students doing agriculture this year. There's three staff there. And the staff have got a real mix of experience or qualifications. Dan Grace is the head of agriculture, and he has a science degree, but he's also worked as a shepherd and a shearer. There's James O'Connor, who I think he's only been there for a year or two. He's got a science degree as well, but he's also a qualified butcher and a qualified plumber. So he's actually been teaching the ag students butchery skills, which are practical skills that you know you want if you're working on a farm.
Really
good mix.
So they can go onto a farm with quite a lot of understanding and experience and confidence to just get on with the job.
Yeah, for sure.
Be great for the farmers.
So and this Rural Trades Academy, I guess, is just the next step in that process. So they, you know, as I say, year two, they are out there.
And do many of them go on and become farmers?
I couldn't give you the numbers, Rob.
But, it surprises me, though, in the practice I meet young folk who that's what they want to do, and they're in their early 20s, and that includes young women who are going to become farmers. That's their
Target. I think of that 340 students, I wouldn't be surprised if it's a 50-50 split between boys and girls. But Dan keeps a good record of students that have gone on and are finishing ag related or at least primary sector related degrees and diplomas and training. So
good. We've got some other photos here. Let me see. I'm not quite sure what these ones are about.
That there is...
it's younger ones.
That is younger ones. That's the education program that Aratoy run.
Oh, I see, of course.
So that there actually may be the Wellesley wing, possibly.
It is. Yeah. I can see it. I can recognise the floorboards. Yeah. So is that their teacher... taking their class in.
I think they've got two staff. No, I think Aratoy have two education staff. They're not full time, but come in and run projects. And as I said, last year there was 3,000 children that went through education projects at Aratoy.
Yeah, so that's one of the classes, and the other one is down here. We'll just go back to that one. Yeah.
Don't ask me what they're doing, Rob.
No. Well, they're sitting in a very special way, which is a little bit yoga-ish, but kids do naturally. We had a yoga class on Saturday, and I talked about it last week.
Yep.
And then I went on the yoga class. It was for a retreat for men.
Okay.
It was fantastic.
You're still walking okay?
Oh, I was. It really was painful. You know about that.
Yeah.
You've tried it.
I've had a go.
God. And the breathing is so brilliant too. And there's another activity of your trust, by the look of things, out on, is that Anakiwa? Is that outward bound?
That is Anakiwa. In fact, I was at a function a week ago, which was just celebrating that course. So Outward Bound run a course now where they take students from each region. And so 14 students from the Wairarapa went to Anakiwa. Of those 14, there was a number of them from Masterton, and the trust provided funding towards that course. So they did 21 days down there, which I think the 21-day courses at Anakiwa are pretty well known. I think they've been doing that for many, many years.
Yeah.
But 14 students went down, and they all learnt a lot and seemed to have a...
So is that an annual thing, or is it a one-off?
It's annually as from this year.
Oh, it's a new one. Yeah.
It's a new course for Outward Bound, this idea of bringing students from the same region together. So the Wairarapa students stayed, they were a group of 14, and they ran through that course together.
Mm.
And I think that is going to be annual for Outward Bound. And,
brilliant.
Possibly.
Kids love it, don't they? It really does extend them. And
I think they develop a lot of skills. I think they sort of say that the outdoors is just the... it's just the classroom, really. They're developing leadership skills and team skills.
And they make great friendships too, don't they?
Yeah.
They get on really well with each other. They have to help each other out.
After 21 days together.
Yeah. So who's this group here? These guys look like they're in a chemistry lab. Do you know about this one?
I couldn't tell you too much about that one, Rob. But
no,
it's,
well. Is it something else you're doing?
There are some other programs we run. That one there, I think, is called Ngā Tamatara, and it's a leadership course for young boys.
Yep.
So we've provided funding for two leadership courses for young people, one for young boys, clearly, and one for young girls.
Yes. I wonder if they make those taiaha. Do you think they will?
I don't know. I don't know.
They're beautifully made, aren't they?
Yeah.
I could imagine that they would have had a woodwork class and some of them are a bit more primitive than others. I mean, look at this one here.
There might be a bit less time in the workshop.
Yeah. Yeah. Might be the end of it. I think we've got to the end of our photos.
Oh, well, that's... If we've got a couple more... grants that I can talk about, Robert.
Yeah, please.
Got a few minutes.
Yeah.
The first one is the Whaka Ori Ori Wellbeing Project, which is a project we've just really kicked off. Well, we've been working on it for the past year, but it's really only just taking off now. And the trust is undertaken to contribute $600,000 over 3 years to this project. And it's a wellbeing project that's working to develop social competence amongst young people.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's really, I've got some words here, it's not something I'm directly involved with, but the social competence is a skill set relating to social, emotional, cognitive and behavioural skills required to handle social interactions. The focus is on young people transitioning from early childhood into primary school and then from intermediate into secondary school. I think
the
transition period has been highlighted as a difficult moment.
Are they recognised as kids who have special needs to come into the program, or is it offered across the board?
No, we looked at that, and I think the answer is no. It really will be offered to anyone, any students making that transition.
Yeah.
And it requires two schools, or an early childhood centre and a school, to come together, because the program's got to traverse over both years, so it'll transition from one to the other. So it's going to be a partnership between schools.
So that's the 5 to 6 year olds? No, 4 to 5 year olds?
4 to 5. So 4 to 5, and then
12 to 13
or 13 to 14 whenever you move through.
Intermediate to high school.
Correct.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's we're thinking that it's looking like it's going to be a 3 year program, so about around about $200,000 a year.
Mm-hmm.
We announced that at a function of 2 or 3 weeks ago now. So hopefully the schools and the early childhood centres are away working on developing up their applications for us.
Yeah.
So these projects can kick off.
That's really exciting. Yeah. Because there are issues that arise in those transitions, that often the schools aren't resourced adequately to pick up on, and the kids stumble on. Do you think you'll have a research component to that? Will you be collecting the information so it can be kind of analysed later?
Certainly, we have a lot more of a drive now to collect information on how our grants are being used, how valuable they are. So, yeah, the answer is yes. Mm. We want to collect a lot of data, and then I guess at the end of 3 years, we'll be able to evaluate whether it was worthwhile and whether it's worth continuing.
So do you have a specialist teacher running that program?
We got a consultant. We engaged a consultant to help us with it. We worked with the Kahuiako, which is a local group of, I think it's about 32 schools that form this Kahuiako, which is a collective that I think look at how they can collaborate together on various aspects. And they came up with this idea of essentially to start with well-being, and then they drilled down into that and came up with this concept of social competence as to where there was a need.
Yeah.
And at that point, we got a consultant involved, and she did a fair bit of work for us.
Yeah.
And now we have local Maria McKenzie, who is an educationalist.
Uh-huh.
She's engaged by the trust to sort of oversee and manage for us. So we're not teachers or educationalists. So she works on our behalf with the schools to develop applications, and then also monitoring the program as it runs its course and collecting data.
Sure. So there'll be quite an involvement with the family of the children. The families.
That is the plan. It has to include families, to be successful, I think.
Yeah, the term that goes with social competence is resilience.
Okay.
And kids need to learn resilience more than ever, probably, and not just rely on tablets and screens and iPhones and things.
Getting back up when you fall off a bulldozer at the park, for example.
Yes. Yeah.
Yeah.
Good. So
and the two other ones quickly, Rob, that are just sort of one-offs for us really at the moment. COVID was affected businesses, as we talked about earlier, but it's also really affected the not-for-profit and NGO sector, and as much as there's a lot of organisations have had greater costs this year because they've had more demand for their service, and they've often had less funding because the likes of trusts and that have had less money to give away. So we quickly put together a $50,000 community support fund post-COVID. So $50,000 the year of which we've given away $28,000 so far to seven different organisations.
And do people apply?
They apply. Yeah. So we've got applications on our website. At the moment, as I say, we've given away $28,000 to the likes of Autism Wairarapa, Senior Net, Alzheimer's Wairarapa, Dress for Success, and a small number of others. But there's still about $22,000 sitting there available.
Because those organisations would have had funding cuts, wouldn't they? Or the charity side of their fundraising would have taken a bit of a hit.
Yeah, absolutely. Look, and often their costs have gone up because the demand for their service has gone up. So
And there's much more awareness too of the extra things that people need when they're suffering autism, or a family with an autistic son or daughter, or someone with dementia, Alzheimer's, and it comes on quite young.
Yeah.
So people can be in their 60s and quite dysfunctional, needing a lot of support, and maybe people haven't planned to deal with that.
Yeah.
So this is a wonderful resource. So you mentioned your website. Would you like to just give us the details of your website? So if people are interested, they can look up a bit more of the detail.
You'll be testing me there, Rob,
that we've covered.
I would just Google www.ltm for Lands Trust Masterton .org.nz.
LTM.
Yeah, Lands Trust Masterton. Yeah. So full name, obviously, Masterton Trust Lands Trust.
Yes.
Gone through a couple of iterations of naming over the past few years.
Yes. Good.
But easy to find.
Yeah.
And look, the other one that we've done this year was a community education fund. And so this fund was put together for this year. It's a one-off at the moment. We put $125,000 into that fund. And that was really, I guess, a response to the fact that we'd been funding schools and schools only for a number of years. And as you know, education runs a bit more broader than just schools. So that $125,000, we've actually given out $128,000. We had to come up with a few more dollars. Mm. But we've funded things like the Outward Bound course that we just discussed.
Yeah.
The Share History Trust, which has got the building just around the corner.
Yep.
On Dixon Street. The House of Science, which puts together science kits for school-aged children.
Mm-hmm.
And the schools can get access to those. We've done some funding with REAP. And also the Wairarapa Rescue Trust got some money for the search and rescue helicopter crew. That helicopter crew got some funding from Trust House recently to get equipment so they could fly over open water, which they'd sort of been doing in gumboots and swan dries, I think, till recently, which is the rules are changing a bit there. But as part of that, so they've got this kit they can fly out for search and rescue as they had to at Matakona a year or so ago.
Yeah.
We've funded some training for them to learn how to get out of that helicopter should it ever go down.
Oh, good. Yeah. Excellent. Wow, what a range of things you're involved with.
Well, yeah, I guess it's a response to the community. These are the sorts of...
So when you say it's community-owned, you don't have shareholders, or do you?
No, not as such, no.
So when you, who is the community that owns it?
Well, I guess...
Is it ratepayers?
No, not directly ratepayers either. I think our act, in terms of where we grant money to, it has to be within a district.
Yep.
And our district boundary is fairly tight. It extends to, I guess, the northern end of Lansdowne, sort of the hill out of town as you go up Opaki Road. And to the west, Fernridge School is just inside the boundary.
Yeah.
To the east, I couldn't draw the line for you, but I think it's around about Macora's Inn, and so it's just a little bit east of Macora.
Probably the rubbish dump.
The rubbish dump. I think rubbish dump was what I was going to say.
Yeah.
And then to the south, the Wanawa River, basically.
Wow.
So that's the extent of our boundaries, and that's where our grants have to stay within that.
So you're profitable and the profits belong to the community, in
correct.
A sense. You do things and you're responsible in the sense that it's a democratic organisation. People are elected.
We have a board of eight.
Yeah.
They have the board members have a term of 6 years. They can re-stand, but everyone's up for
re-election. That's a good long stretch.
It's long enough. It takes a while. So the voting is with the local authority elections, local body elections, every 3 years.
Of course.
And so
course.
Four of the trustees are up for re-election on each three-year cycle.
Mm.
So you get some continuity. At least four of them are going to roll over it.
Out of six?
Out of eight.
Out of eight.
But a 6 year term is good. I think if you take education, for example, there's quite a lot to get in and understand and change if that's what needs to happen.
Mm.
And 3 years is, I don't believe it gives you enough time.
No, exactly. And people come with a passion, with an agenda, don't they? They've got a reason for wanting to become trustees, and it's going to take them some time to argue the case and get to know what exactly is possible, and then whatever leadership's required, you know, it all takes time.
Yeah, look, absolutely. I think we had Carl Toucher, who finished up a year or so ago. I think he was a trustee for 18 years.
18 years,
so
really?
He did, you know, 3 6-year cycles.
Yes.
But,
Hey, well, thanks for the history. Thanks for the current description of what's going on. And thank you for bringing those initiatives to the community.
No,
it's fantastic.
A pleasure. So thanks for having me in, Rob.
And I thought we'd go out with Greg Johnson, who's, as you know, he's a New Zealand songwriter, This is a song titled Maori King. Okay.
I was driving down country road alone when I saw a crowd of people standing out on the road. I pulled alongside and wound my window down while the radio played Darkness on the Edge of Town. From wooden buildings I heard many voices sing. A man said they're waiting for the Maori King. Don't be afraid to disappear. So many moments have conspired to lead us here. There goes another year. Oh baby, there goes another year. And I realized that I was waiting too.
I've been waiting too.
For the moment that I'll be back with you. And just the thought of you
thought
makes me wanna sing.
Makes me wanna sing.
Kinda like I'm waiting for. Waiting for the Maori King. Don't be afraid to disappear. So many moments have conspired to lead us here. There goes another year. Oh baby, there goes another year. So I flashed a peace sign to the meanest looking guy of all time. But he just flipped the finger back at me.
Flipped the finger.
And I realized that I was angry too.
I was angry.
For all the time that I forced away from you. Now just the thought of you
thought
makes me wanna sing.
Makes me wanna sing.
Kinda like I'm waiting for. It's like I'm waiting, waiting for the Maori King. Well, I drove away smiling as I went. I was thankful for the moment spent. Just the thought of it makes me wanna sing. Kinda like I'm waiting for. Waiting for. Waiting for the Maori King.
It's Greg Johnson from an album he put out in 2010, recorded in Santa Monica, titled Secret Weapon, and that was Maori King, a lovely song from Greg. And we've just had Andrew Crosgrey from the Masterton Licensing Trust, the Masterton Trustlands Trust. He's their general manager, talking to us about all the wonderful things that MLT do for the community. We're getting near the end of the program. I did indulge a bit in talking with Andrew, but I'd like to just give you a couple of events that are coming up. Tonight in Carterton at 6:30, there's the Community Music Co-Creation Wānanga with Yonish Kirkle leading that. It's a wonderful event. You don't have to take instruments. They're all provided. It's good for kids and mums and dads and older folk as well, just to join in a co-musical creation event. And that's at Heart of Arts in Carterton, 6:30. Then again on Saturday at 4:30, there's the men's group Overnight in the Wilderness. Goes from 4:30 on Saturday through to midday on Sunday. It's a camping by the fire next to the river for men over the age of 17 or 14 if you're accompanied by a father, grandfather or caregiver. Need to carry your own gear. It's about a 15-minute walk into the bush. The contact for that is the men's group -wairarapa.nz. So there's a website, www.mensgroup www.mingle-wairarapa.nz. That's for the men's group overnight in the wilderness this Saturday from 4:30. On Friday evening at the Tin Hut, Grafia Productions are hosting Tin Hut Live with three musical items. There's the Martinborough Community Choir, led by Vic Jones. They'll be on from about 7:45. There's a wonderful rhythm and blues band from the Hutt Valley, Wellington area called Ain't Superstitious. They'll be playing from about 8:30. And Jonathan Burkham, who's the Cross Creek Blues Club Carterton District Council Music Fellow, he's here for 3 weeks composing a classical folk piece, which the Wairarapa Singers and the Regional Orchestra will play. He's going to be playing his piano accordion accompanied by members of Grafia from about 7:20, Friday night at the Tin Hut. It's $15 per person, but if you come as a group of five, it's $30. So the door fee is down to $6 if you're in a group of five. So do come along and check out that wonderful music scene. I daren't run over time because the plug will be pulled if I do. Again, thank you for listening. Thanks to Andrew for coming and giving his wonderful insights and encouraging news about the work of the Masterton Trust Lands Trust. And from me, Rob Maunsell, signing off for another week from MMP. It's goodbye for now.